o'clock, and we cannot wait to get started. So we're going to go ahead and get started this morning. Let me double check one more time because y'all know I like to do this. There's no birthdays or anniversaries in the parking lot. Okay, all right then. Well, somebody needs to come next week with a birthday. So we're going to go ahead and get started. We're going to open up our service with Our God. Listen, if there be any visitors here with us this morning, aka Katie's family, thank y'all for being with us. We love you guys. We're excited to see y'all this morning. So we're going to go ahead and get started with Our God.
Turned into wine. Open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you. None like you. Into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger, God, you are higher than any other, our God is healer, awesome in power, our God,
y'all honk a horn, let us know you're happy to be here this morning.
Into the darkness you shine. Our God is healer, awesome in power.
see if you can hear me. All right, settle down, settle down. It's good to see everybody this morning. It's really good to be here. The sun is out and the preacher's going to be sweating, all right? So the Holy Spirit's going to pour it out on him and it's just going to be sweating and it's going to be good today. So I want you right now to start praying. Pray for your pastor. Pray that the Lord will anoint him. Pray that everything done today is not an entertainment factor. It's not so that we can just enjoy ourselves. It's so that we can worship the Lord ourselves. I'm sorry, let me replace that. We ourselves can worship the Lord, our God. Okay? Want to pray with you and we're going to get started. I don't have very many announcements. I quit doing those because, well, we don't ever get doing those things. We hope to really soon be able to get back into a process to get back into our building. But look, this is amazing. This is amazing to have you all here. You know, I believe we have more people attending church through our parking lot, YouTube, and Facebook than we ever had before. So I thank you so much for that. You know, sometimes the Lord does things for us that we don't realize for our own good and for His glory, and we don't realize it. And that's the thing that we got to understand about Romans 8:28. It's for those that serve Him, that love Him, and live according to His commandments. So let's pray together. Heavenly Father, Lord, we call on You today, Lord, to be with us this morning as we come together and worship You. Lord, we lift up Preacher Don to You, Lord, and just ask that You would anoint him, Lord, that You would give him what he needs today, Lord, that You would have him preach to us and share with us. God, I pray, Lord, that You would be with our hearts and our minds this morning. Lord, despite the cars and any distractions, Lord, I pray that You would put those behind us and allow us to worship You, to focus on You. God, we love You. We thank You that we have this opportunity. We thank You for this beautiful sunshine. And God, be with us this day as we worship You, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Good morning.
Amen, amen. We are going to sing this song again this morning, Waymaker. Many of you know that song, but hopefully it's not, I don't want you guys to hear our voices while we sing it. I really want you to more so focus on the words, y'all, because we need this right now. We really need this. I don't know anybody who doesn't need a waymaker in their life, or a miracle worker, or a promise keeper. And I'm sure that most of you here, you have that, and you have that hope in Jesus Christ. But, you know, I'm going to be real. Somebody doesn't. It may be somebody in your life, and you need to tell them about the waymaker and the miracle worker. But I really hope this morning that you can just be thankful that you have that hope. And if not, you can get it this morning. So we're going to sing this song. Y'all pray for us.
You are here, touching every
Right now, something said, something sung, something done today will give them that through your name, Jesus. We want everything through your name, Lord. We want you to be glorified. It's all about you. And I just pray right now that you would just anoint Preacher Don and give him the words to say and give him the power to give this message so that it can touch lives and change lives so that people can know you are the miracle worker and the promise keeper. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for this time. Thank you for this fellowship. I just pray for the remainder of this service and that it's all for your glory, Jesus. In your precious and holy name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. That's my Michael.
Can you turn his mic on?
One, two, still nothing? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. We can fix that.
Bye-bye, Dim.
Good morning. Man, it's good to be saved, amen. I'm thankful to be counted a child of the King. If you're here, you're glad to be saved, amen. The Bible says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. How about say so this morning? Amen. Amen. Guys, we got a message that we preached from this passage. It's been about a year and a half ago, and God just would like not let me get away from this thing, and I will share this with you this morning. But there's three quick questions that God would ask on that day. You have your Bibles, I'm going to ask you to go ahead and turn to Matthew chapter 27. We're going to begin reading in verse 15. Matthew 27 and verse 15. And I want to preach this morning. I want to speak this morning on this thought. What's the question? What's the question? Pilate gives three questions, one right after another, that I want to share with you this morning, that in 2020 still must be answered. You'll answer this question today, whether you like it or not, amen. This will preach, I'm not going to make a decision today. Well, you've already made a decision. You made a decision to reject him, to shun him. Let's go ahead and start reading, guys. In Matthew chapter 27, in verse 15, the Bible says, now at the feast, the governor was accustomed to release from the crowd any one prisoner whom they wanted. They had then a notorious prisoner called Barabbas. So when they had gathered, Pilate said to them, whom do you want me to release for you, Barabbas or Jesus, who is called the Christ? For he knew that it was out of envy that they had delivered him up. Besides, while he was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent word to him, saying, have nothing to do with that righteous man, for I have suffered much because of him in a dream. Now the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas and destroy Jesus. First question. The governor asked them again, said to them again, which of the two do you want me to release him? Which of the two? Which one of these do you want? What you going to do with this man called Jesus? And they said, Barabbas. Release Barabbas. Pilate said to them again, question two. Then what shall I do with Jesus who is called the Christ? What you going to do with Jesus? What you going to do with Jesus? They all said, let him be crucified. Verse 23. And he said, why? What evil has he done? But they shouted all the more, let him be crucified. So when Pilate saw that he was gaining nothing, but rather a riot was about to begin, he took water and he washed his hands before the crowd, saying, I am innocent of this man's blood. See to it yourselves. And all people answered, his blood be on us and on our children. Then he released for them Barabbas. Having scourged Jesus, he delivered him to be crucified. Lord, I love you. God, I know that if anything's done in this place today, God, it will not be because of Don's wife. God, I thank you for what you've called me to do. I thank you, God, for allowing me this platform to do this on God. But I've got enough sense to know, Lord, that nothing that's done here will be because of you. Father, I ask you now to hide me behind the cross. I pray, God, that you give me the words to say, God. I pray you'd remind me when to stop. But I just ask you to help me. God, please lead and guide me in the way that you'd have me to go. God, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen, amen. Guys, life's full of questions. And I let the devil know, amen, we got the wind problem under control today. I don't have to worry about holding this and holding that. And I'm not blessed with the memory like Brother Don is, amen. Maybe one day, I believe it's maybe too far out down the road for that to happen now. But God can do anything. But I just wasn't blessed with the memory, guys. I just wasn't. so I write down what God gives me, amen, so I don't forget it. Now, I had a tough time last week, you know? That's my part of study, I guess. I write down as God talks to me, and we have a conversation. But devil, just so you know, wherever you're at, amen, we got the wind situation under control today. I want to share with you, life's full of questions, guys. Today, those three questions we just talked about, we're going to look at those. Pilate asked the people there before, or during the trial of Jesus, three questions that will be, must be, have to be answered even today in 2020. You can like it or not, I've already mentioned, you like it or not, you're going to answer these questions. I can like it or not, but I'm going to answer these questions. First question, back in verse 21, the Bible says, the governor again said to them, which of the two do you want me to release to you? And they said, Barabbas. What type of life do you want to live? What type of life do you want to live? I got a lot of scripture today, guys. What do you do? What will you do with Jesus this morning? I pray the folks that are watching on Facebook or on YouTube, these questions, amen. It's not just for these folks in this parking lot this morning. It's not just for folks that maybe can hear, or maybe there's some folks that are sitting at their home right now, amen, that are within about a mile and a half, and they can tune this in on their radio at home. And maybe they're listening. But whoever you are, you're going to answer these questions today. There has to be an answer for it. What will you do with Jesus? When we're offered a choice between Jesus and anything else, on this day that we're offered Barabbas or Jesus, look, that choice you make is going to affect every day of your life. Not just that moment, not a moment in it. Every day of your life, the choice you make for Jesus, it affects everyday life. And depending on how you answer these questions this morning, will determine your lifestyle. I do want to ask that, how are you living this morning? What kind of life are you living this morning? Are we living a life that's pleasing to God, amen? Are we living a life trying to hide behind the trees, amen, because we've sinned on the Lord? And by the way, He knows where we are. Anybody believe that God didn't know where Adam was when he came down in the cool of the day, just like always, to walk with him? He said, Adam, where are you? God knew where Adam was. God wanted Adam to know where Adam was. That's like we ask our kids when you walk in and there's flour all over the kitchen, strung everywhere, you say, what are you doing? You know what they're doing. You just want to make sure that they know what they're doing. So what are you going to do with Jesus? Will you choose this life of sin and rejection toward God? If you choose that, this lifestyle of sin, amen, I want to share something with you. This life, the life of sin, is out of control. You're out of control. I got scripture, Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 3. It's a life that's out of control. How many of you was like I was? I'm just telling you. Brother, I thought that I had it all going on when I was lost. I thought I was living my life just like I wanted to, doing exactly what I wanted to do. Truth is, I was a slave to the devil. I didn't even realize, amen, that he was my master, sister. Right? I didn't realize that I was just following his lead. I thought that I was doing everything, amen, that I wanted to do. Now, the devil's leading us astray. It's a life out of control if you're not following Jesus. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 3. And you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath like the rest of mankind. I'll tell you something, Satan's your God and your guide. Listen to me, if you're not saved, if you're not born again, I know that makes you mad, because it made me mad. A good friend of mine was saved years ago, amen, as we worked together. His name's Keith Richardson. And he come back to work after about a week. I mean, he came back the next day, and about a week later, he started witnessing to me, telling me I need to go to church and I need to do this and that. You know how it is. You don't want to hear that stuff. You don't want to hear that stuff, amen, if you're lost. And he came up to me one day, Sister Francis, he said, you know something, Don? You can't even pray for your children. I said, do what? I said, you're crazy. He said, you can't even pray for your sick children if you're lost. I'm going to tell you what I said. I said, you're a liar. I said, I don't believe that for a moment. He said, Don, why would God be obligated to do anything for you if you don't trust Him? Please don't get me wrong, guys. God takes care of us in our lowest part. Even when we don't look, He still takes care of us. But the Bible plainly says, amen, those that are disobedient, God's not listening. The only prayer that God hears, amen, from a lost person, it's in your Bible if you read it. The only prayer He is a prayer of repentance. And it made me mad when Keith told me this. He said, you know what the Bible says, Don? He said, the Bible says that you can't serve two masters. You'll love the one. Listen to me now. Be mad at the preacher if you want to, but I'm telling you what the Bible says. The Bible says you'll love the one and hate the other. Now, who are you going to believe? You're going to believe what you think or what I think, we're going to believe what the scripture says. And Keith told me, he could have said it a little better. He said maybe a little different, but maybe that wouldn't have got my attention. Because the way he said it, he said, you're a devil worshiper. Really? I said, do what? And I was ready to go at him. I was ready to go to him because I was mad. He said, yeah. But what's the Bible say, guys? The Bible says that you can't serve two masters. You're serving one or you're serving the other. This life without Jesus, amen, is a life that's completely out of control. You're not the one leading what you're doing. You're allowing the devil to lead. Second thing is a life with no peace. It's a life with no peace. Isaiah 48:22. There is no peace for the wicked, says the Lord. There is no peace for the wicked, says the Lord. You may be here and think you got everything going on, but you're lost. You don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior. Look, there's a little bit of easy times. It'll always come. There's a little bit of times where no problem comes in your life. That's very short-lived, and you know that. You know that. Everybody knows that. There is absolutely no peace. It's a life with no peace when you don't have Jesus. God Himself said in Isaiah, there is none. There is no peace for the wicked. Something missing. Something missing in everybody's life that doesn't have Jesus. And it's peace. It's the peace that passes all understanding. It's a life that has no lasting joy. There'll be pleasures. They'll be very short-lived. But there's pleasure in sin. Even Moses said that. There's pleasure in sin, amen. But at the end of that season, lies death, destruction, and hell, guys. A life with no lasting peace. A life with no peace, no joy. It's a life of condemnation. John 3:18 says this. John 3:18. Whoever believes in Him is not condemned. But whosoever does not believe is condemned already. Because he has not believed in the name of the only Son of God. Amen. Now here's something. God will hold you and me accountable for the way I live my life. Today, nobody's accountable for anything. It's somebody else's fault. It's the Chinese fault for the virus. It's our fault for the virus. It's somebody else's fault for the virus. Look, truth be known, it's our fault. It's all of us' fault, amen. Sin has caused this in our world. Am I guilty? Are you guilty? Absolutely, we're all guilty. And if you're living a life that you don't know Jesus, you're living a life, I'm living a life of condemnation. It's a life of hopelessness. How about this? Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 12. It's a life of hopelessness. Remember that you were at that time separated from Christ, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of the promise, having no hope and without God in the world. And that's what the majority of folks that we see before this, keeping us at home all the time. You go out and talk to folks and share with folks, and people have just lost hope. They've lost hope in everything. And if you're living a life like this, if you've chosen, amen, Barabbas, so to speak, over Jesus, you're living a life of hopelessness. You've got no hope. What is your hope in? What is your hope in? Okay, I'll be the first one. I'm a great example to tell you right here this morning. You better not put your hope in a 401k or a retirement plan. I can tell you that right now from experience and know that, amen. You better not put your hope in that. You better not put your hope in a job. Because I'll tell you right now, you're just a number. They don't care, I'll promise you. Go bankrupt tomorrow, bless God. What is your hope in, guys? Is it your retirement? Is it your stocks? Is it your family? Is it your husband, your wife, your kids? The only hope, amen, in this world is Jesus. And if you're living this life, amen, if you're living this life lost, you don't have any hope. Amen, hallelujah. No hope in this life. So, if you choose that path, you're going to choose the other path. Will you choose a life of salvation and blessings of God? This lifestyle for the ones that choose Jesus, we're going to reverse this thing, amen. It is a life that's under control. It is a life that's under control. Galatians chapter 5 and verse 16. But I say, walk by the Spirit and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. If you walk by the Spirit, God said, Jesus said, you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. You know what this stuff wants to do? What it wants to do. And it's only evil. There's nothing good within us. There's nothing good about us, amen. Even Jesus Himself said that. The rich young ruler comes up to Him and says, good master, good teacher, rabbi, what must I do? What good thing must I do to inherit eternal life? You know what Jesus said to him? This is Jesus, the Son of God. He says, there is none good but my Father which are in heaven. Wow. You know why Jesus answered him like that? I believe we touched on this last week. Because there's nothing good that you can do. You can't be good enough. There's no good in us, amen. All the good, if there's any good at all, and there is good, and He is all that's good, is found in Jesus. I told you, I believe even last week, we're gathered here right now, amen. This isn't for His good. This ain't going to do Him a bit of good, amen. I'm just being honest with you. I'm not saying it doesn't bring a smile to His face, amen. But this doesn't bring God. It's not for His good. It's for our good. It's God's glory, but it's not for His good. He don't mean any good that we got. Our goodness, our righteousness is like filthy rags. God is good. You live a life trusting in the Lord. You live a life that's under control. This flesh, it's still a battle every day, man. Every day it's a battle. This flesh will rise up and you have to fight like crazy. You have to stay on your knees and in your Bible, amen, to overcome the desires of the flesh. Hey, how about this life for Jesus? It's a life with peace. It's a life with peace. John chapter 14, verse 27. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. This is the peace. He said, peace I leave with you. There's total commitment, total contentment. Total contentment. There's times in my life where I find myself, amen, I wish I had more of this, I wish I had more of that or less of this, amen. But I will tell you, I find, especially the older I get, Brother Richard, I find it more and more, I'm just content with the way God's. I'd love to have, look guys, who would, I'd love to have more money. I'd love to have a new truck, amen. I'd love to have all these things, but I'm telling you right now, the older I get, the more I'm contented with what God's given me. I guess if He sees it's okay and it's good enough, amen, who am I to complain about? I want to thank God, amen. This is a life of peace. This is a life of absolute contentment. No, it's no perfection, but contentment, amen. Joy unspeakable and full of glory. This life in Jesus is a life that's free from condemnation. Romans 8 and 1, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. If you're saved, you're born again, amen. Jesus, God does not condemn you anymore. He does not look down. If you know Jesus as your Savior, He doesn't look down and see your sins anymore. He sees the blood of Jesus applied to your life. Hallelujah. He doesn't see the flaws and all His sorriness and all my filth, amen, and all my shame. And all He sees is the blood of Jesus. Now, I'm not condemned anymore. Free from condemnation. Psalm 103, verse 12. Listen to this. Talked about this just a little bit, Brother Don, this morning. We're talking about what we want to do Wednesday night. Listen to what Psalm 103 says, verse 12. As far as the east is from the west, so far does He remove our transgressions from us. As far as the east is from the west, He says, that's where I've thrown your sins. I've thrown them into the sea of forgetfulness, never to be remembered or brought up against you anymore. If I've forgiven you, you've forgiven, amen. The devil may bring it back to your remembrance. You may sit there and wallow with it and wrangle with it and wrestle with it, amen. But I'm telling you, God has forgiven me. If God has forgiven me, who am I to bring it back up, amen? As far as the east is from the west, what does that mean, preacher? Does that have any significance? You better believe it does. As far as the east is from the west, it sounds like a good thing to say. Sounds like a good quote to put in the Bible, amen. But I will tell you what it means. You know, if you would start off today, if you would go to the North Pole, and you'd start walking or traveling, flying, or driving, whatever, if you'd start at the North Pole going south, you keep going and keep going and keep going and keep going, amen. There's coming a point when you get to the south. You get to the south, and you keep walking, amen, you're going to start going north again. You're going to start going north now, amen. You're not going south anymore. Listen to what I'm trying to tell you. The Bible says that God has thrown our sins as far as the east is from the west. If you take off today from right here and start going east, and you just continue to walk and continue, you're always going east. You're never going to end up west. You're always going in the easterly direction, amen. God says, that's how far I'm throwing your sins. You couldn't get to them if you wanted to. You can't track them down, amen. The devil can't go find them and bring them back to you. He says, I've thrown those jokers away for you as far as the east is from the west. That's good stuff, amen. That's good stuff. That's what God does. That's what He says. I didn't realize until I had this tablet in front of me how much I spit when I preach. Looked like a stinking rainfall up here, amen. It's a good thing that we have all that distance between us in church. I'd give a whole new meaning to be anointed, amen. If y'all pray for me. A life free from condemnation. A life. If this is a life that we have that is full of hope. It's full of hope. 1 Peter 3:5. 1 Peter 1:3-5. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to His great mercy, He has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. To an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. Amen. A better place is waiting for you. A better place is waiting for me. You know, we don't talk about that a whole lot anymore, brother. Brothers, we don't talk about that a whole lot anymore. We talk about things that we need to do to overcome situations in our lives. We talk about things and we study things, we read things, amen, to overcome daily problems. No, but I want to tell you something, amen. There's a heaven that I get to go to when this life is over. We don't just go to the ground, amen. We don't have to continue on in the same thing we're in right now. God says, I prepared a place for you, amen. And I'm looking forward to it. We're going to touch on that in just a minute. We got a hope beyond this world. This life is full of hope if you know Jesus. Second question. Back in verse 22 of our text, the second question. Pilate said to them, then what shall I do with Jesus who is called the Christ? What am I going to do? Where do you want to spend eternity? That's a no-brainer to me. I mean, where do you want to spend eternity? I don't want to go to hell. Can I tell you something, and you not be mad at me? The reason I got saved is because I didn't want to go to hell. I hadn't fell head over heels in love with Jesus. I hadn't. I'd heard it preached about how awful hell was, amen. I knew about how good heaven was. We heard it preached also. But I didn't want to die and go to hell. I didn't want to be in torment forever, amen. Some people say, preacher, I don't really believe in a burning literal hell. Well, you need to tell Jesus that. Because Jesus spoke more about a torment and eternal punishment, amen, in a place of fire where there's wailing and gnashing of teeth. He spoke more about that than He did heaven. So I won't side up with him, amen. So don't get mad at me if I don't take off on the trail that you're going down, all right? The Bible says there is a hell to shun. There's a heaven to gain. Where do you want to spend your eternity? Proverbs 9:12. If you are wise, you are wise for yourself. If you scoff, you alone will bear it. Can I put that in just plain old Darlington County, Horry County terms? It's your choice. You're going to make the decision. You're going to live with it if it's good. You're going to live with it if it's bad. Bottom line, it's your choice, amen. Thessalonians. 2 Thessalonians, amen. Listen, guys, to refuse Jesus is to be eternally lost. Lost and doomed to hell. Nobody wants to talk about it anymore. We're going to talk about it this morning, amen. Thank God for heaven. I get to go. Woo! But there's a hell. There's a hell, guys. All that love that God showers on us, amen. There's a wrath on the other side of it. For those who don't live right, that they don't accept His gift. If you go. You know, a lot of folks tell you, well, a God that loves you like you preach about, all that love, they say, Brother Charlie, they say, well, if this God that you talk about, and the Bible's full of love, it says God is love, a God like that won't send you to hell. Hey, listen, God doesn't send anybody to hell. God doesn't send anybody to hell. We choose to go there. We choose to go there. It's our choice. He's made a way. He's done everything He can do, amen, to keep us out of hell. And we're still running wide open as hard as we can to get there. It's our choice. It's our choice. Listen to this. To refuse the Lord is to be lost and doomed to hell. Eternal hell and the horrors of the 2 Thessalonians 1:9. 2 Thessalonians 1:9. They will suffer the punishment of eternal destruction away from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of His might. Eternal separation from God, that would be hell. That'd be hell enough. How about this Psalm 9:17? You've got to see our country somewhere along in here. This happened to other countries, amen. It'll happen in our country if we continue down this path we're on. The Bible says in Psalm verse 9, chapter 9 and verse 17, the wicked shall be turned into hell and all the nations that forget God. All the nations that forget God will be turned into hell. I'm telling you, we're on a fast track. We're on a fast track, and you know it as well as I do. Even the birds is praising the Lord this morning. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. God's good. God's good. Amen. I mean, to choose Jesus, though, is to be saved and headed for heaven. Heaven and all its glories. Listen to this. Revelation chapter 21 and verse 4. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. Heaven is yours. Heaven is yours and heaven is mine if I trust in Jesus. He's promised it to you. The preacher didn't promise to you. God promised it to you. If you trust in the Lord, amen. John chapter 1 and verse 12. But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become the children of God. He gave the right to become the children of God. What's the qualification? What's the requirements? Amen. To believe. You got to believe in him. Repent, believe, and live. Amen. How about this, church? 1 John chapter 3 and verse 2. 1 John chapter 3 and verse 2. Beloved, we are God's children now, and what we will be has not yet appeared. But we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, because we shall see him as he is. It's coming today. You think I've messed up, amen? You think my body's on the wrong places? You think I got this and I got that? No hair here, amen? Need some more hair there? I'm just telling you. I'll tell you, when he comes on the scene, the Bible says that I'm going to be perfect. I'm going to be like him. We're going to be like him. That's one of the things God gives us, amen. I'm looking forward to this place called heaven. Your choice. Second question, where do you want to spend eternity? You've got to answer that. You're going to answer that, amen. You might not do it vocally or out loud to me, but you're going to answer that question. I don't know where you want to go. I got no business in hell, amen. I'm sweating up here, and it's a nice, cool, breezy day, and I'm sweating. I ain't got no business in hell. Amen. Question 3. Go to verse, back to verse 23 in our text. And he said, this is the one that I've just been wanting to get to so much. This third question. Listen to what it says. Pilate's asking the crowd. I'm asking you this morning. I'm asking everyone in the cars, me. I'm asking these ladies up here, you folks out on YouTube and Facebook. I want to ask you this question. Let me read this verse. Pilate asked him, he said, why do you want Jesus crucified? The words before this, back in 22, they all said, let him be crucified. And Pilate looks at him and says, why? Why? What has he done? What has he done? What has he done to you that you want him to die? Why? What has he done? The third question is a question of decision. This is a question of whether you're here this morning and you reject him, or if you accept him this morning. This is a question that you're going to have to deal with. What evil has he done? What evil has he done? As God was leading us to this place, amen, I wrote this down. I'm going to ask you. I'm going to read it right off just like God. What bad thing did Jesus do to you that has caused you to tell him no? What awful thing has he done to you for you to continue to reject him? What's he done to you? Pilate said, why? Why do you want him to die? He says, I found no fault in this man. Why? What has he done to you? There was a little girl. I've told this story a couple of times here at church. Back in White Savannah, we had vacation Bible school. Man, this has been a long time ago. There was a little girl. I want to say she was probably, I don't know, somewhere between 6 and 9 maybe. But vacation Bible school was coming. She'd asked her daddy. She asked her daddy the first night. I said, Daddy, will you go to vacation Bible school with me? She'd heard about it. This is not a church boy, little girl. Amen. But her mom was taking her. And she had heard about what all they were going to do, have Bible stories and do crafts and all. And she asked her daddy on that day, on that Monday, when he got home from work, he said, Daddy, will you go to Bible school with me? And he's sitting there in the recliner. He's got his beer. He's got TV on. He says, oh, baby, I'm tired. I don't want to go. I'm going to stay right here. She goes, she comes home, amen, jumps up in his lap, brings little colored pages home. She tells the stories and lessons she's learned that day and talks about how Jesus died on the cross. And next night, Tuesday night, she comes into her daddy's. He's sitting there in the chair, giving his beer in his hand, watching TV. He says, "Daddy, vacation Bible school's again tonight. Will you go with us? Will you go with us?" She says, "No, baby, I'm tired." He sits there and he continues to drink, and they go out to church. This is done each night. Daddy never goes. He never goes. So on Sunday night, when they have commencement, that's where they all come together and show what they've done through the week, tell the stories, they mean, get their certificates and all, and the kids will come up front and they'll sing and all. And, you know, she's excited about it. She goes to her daddy, amen, on Sunday. He's watching the ball game again, got his beer in his hand, sitting there in the recliner. Guys, this is a true story. She comes up to her daddy, says, "Daddy, we're going to have fun tonight. You'll be able to see what we've done all week and what we've learned this week. And Daddy, will you go to church with me? Come to Vacation Bible School." And he looks at her and says, "No, I'm not going." This little girl turns and she looks her daddy in the eye, straight in his face. She said, "Daddy, why don't you love Jesus?" He said, "He should love you." She leaves and go to church. They open the service and sing a few songs about that time. Hear the door open in the church. And this daddy walks in, and he sits down towards the back. After they give out all the achievements, the certificates and all, and we have an invitation, he gets up and he comes down to an old-fashioned altar and asks God to forgive him of his sins. He repents, he believes, and he lives. I'm asking you the same question this morning that that little girl asked her daddy. "Daddy, why don't you love Jesus?" Because he sure does love you. Had it not been from the mouth of a baby, amen, continue to ask Daddy to come. Continue to ask Daddy to come and then look him in his face and say, "Daddy, why don't you love him? Why? What bad thing has he done to you? What evil thing has he done to you? He loves you. He died for you. He desires to be with you. He calls you to come to him." And I want to move this over from someone that's lost, amen. If you're lost, amen, what bad thing has he done? I'm going to say it again before I move to this. What bad thing has he done to you that you won't accept him and his love? What bad thing has he done to you? Christian, I'm going to talk to you just a second. We're almost done. Christian, I want to ask you something. What has Jesus done to you that has caused you to walk away from him? Listen to me, because I know there's a couple of guys out there on Facebook today that are watching this. Brother, sister, what bad thing did Jesus do to you that's caused you to walk off of him? What did he do? What bad thing has he done that's caused us to cheat on him? That's caused us to ignore him? Listen, remember what he's done for us. He saved us when we deserve nothing but hell. Huh? He saved us when we deserve nothing but hell. He has never left you and he's never forsaken you for a moment. Remember what he's done for us? He's provided you with everything that you need. I said, "Preacher, you just don't know how bad I got it in my life, amen." Yeah, but you've got to understand something too. You've received everything that you've ever needed because you're here today. You're here, you're breathing today, amen. You're living today. So you have, up until this moment right now, God has provided you with everything that you need. That's good stuff, man. We may not have everything we want, but God's promised us. He said, "I'm going to give you everything that you need." We got to remember what he's done for us. You know what else he does? He loves us constantly and consistently. All the time. It's unconditionally. No matter how bad I am, Brother Johnny, he loves me the same. No matter if I sit down all day and read my Bible for 24 hours, amen, or if tomorrow I don't read it a lick, you know what the God that I'm serving does? He loves me the same. We can't understand that kind of love. But that's how he loves us. You know what else he's doing right now today, right now? Because we're all still living. We're all still breathing. God right now is preparing a place for you and me. As we sit out here on Sunday morning, amen, under the sky that he's created on a beautiful day, the birds singing, you're sitting here worshiping and thanking God, amen. You know what he's doing over in glory? He's preparing you a place right now. Right now. He's working on a place. Hey, when it's done, you know what he's going to do? He's going to come get you. When it's done, he's going to come pick us up. Whether we go by the way of the rapture, by death, the grave, amen, it's okay. It's okay. No one looks forward to death. Nobody, we're all, we have that doubt, that part of uncertainty in us. And nobody wants to leave their families, but this is the, Paul says, man, I'm caught between a rock and a hard place. And my brother Houston, we talked about him coming in. He said, I don't know. He said, man, I'd love to go and be with Jesus. I'd love to go to heaven right now, be with the Lord. He said, but it's better that I stay here and that I can share this story with other people that don't know. I gotta hurry. He's preparing that place. Can anybody in this place on Facebook, in this parking lot, give me one good reason why we walk away from someone who loves us that much? Why don't you come home today? We're gonna read this story, and we're done. And he said there was a man that had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the share of property that's coming to me. Give me my inheritance. And he divided the property between the boys. Not many days later, the young son gathered all that he had and took a journey into a far country. And there he squandered his property in reckless living and riotous living. And when he had spent everything, a severe famine arose in that country, and he began to be in need. So he went and he hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him into the fields to feed the pigs. And he was longing to be fed with the pods or the husks that the pigs ate, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have more than enough bread? But I perish here with hunger. I will arise and go to my father, and I'll say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of the hired servants. And he arose, and he came to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt compassion, and he ran to him, and he hugged him, and he kissed him. And the son said, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you, and I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, bring quickly the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his hand. That ring means something, you hear me? At that time, that ring, it had a family crest on it. It had a signet. That meant that you were part of the family. When he left, when he went and did what he did, he had to leave the ring. He'd broken fellowship with the father, amen. But now he's come home. You know what the father says? Go get that ring, amen. My son's back home. Put this ring on his finger and put shoes on his feet and bring the fatted calf and kill it, lest let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to celebrate. Why don't you come home today? Why don't you come home today? The Bible says, I just read you the story. I just read you the passage of scripture there. The Father's waiting. He's waiting. He's been looking for you to come home. The only way you can see something, the scripture said, the Father saw him afar off. You've got to be looking to see something afar off. If you look long enough, you can pick an airplane out of the sky. If you look long enough, you can see it way off in the distance. It's not just going to pop into your sight. This dad has been looking for this boy to come home. I'm going to share something with you this morning. You're out there on Facebook, amen, or YouTube, or here in this parking lot. That's God. You know you need to come home. God's waiting. I'm telling you, he's waiting right there where you walked off and left him from. He wants you to come home this morning. You've got to answer these questions. Just like Pilate asked this crowd over 2,000 years ago, you've got to answer. Listen to this. Don't you want the best life that you can have here and now? Look, I'm not talking about a book that was put out by a flashy eyebrow fella. I'm not talking about that. You don't live your best life here. If you're living your best life here, I mean, you're not going to heaven. But don't you want to live the very best life here that you can? I do. Hey, what about this? Don't you want to live the very, very best life that you can in eternity? Hey, you can have the best of both worlds if you'll accept Jesus. Here and there. That's a good deal. I ask you this morning, please respond to him this morning. Ask me to please. I don't know where you find yourself. Maybe, again, if there's something strong this morning, somebody, I believe God with all my heart, somebody on Facebook or YouTube this morning, somebody's dealing, somebody's going straight through some things, just come home. Just come home. He just wants you to come home. He loves you and he wants you to come home. You don't have to get out of your cars. You can come home. All you've got to do is bow your head and ask the Lord to forgive you of your sin. God, I've gotten off track. Please help me back. I just want to come home, Lord. I want to have that fellowship that I once had with you. I want to feel that closeness that I once had with you, amen. I want to wake up in the morning when I see the clouds and the sun. I want those holy doodaddies to run up and down my back, amen, like they used to. God, that's what I want. I want a new relationship. I need some fresh oil, God. I need you to restore to me the joy of thy salvation. That's what David said. David said, I was in a mess. Psalm 51. He said, I sinned. did a lot of bad things. God, please don't take your spirit away from me. God, please restore to me the joy of full salvation. I'm asking you, I'm going to pray. Won't you come home today? Won't you come home today? Father, I love you and I thank you for this time. I thank you for this opportunity, God, to be able to share this word. I pray now, God, as these ladies sing, I pray, God, now that your spirit moves out there on whatever platform folks are in this parking lot, God, as they're watching it home or wherever, I pray that you...